We want to welcome you to Crossroads, and those of you joining us online, we're very glad that you're joining us today as we celebrate. This is actually Christmas Sunday. I know it's just still 4 or 5 days away, but this is Christmas Sunday, so we're very, very glad that you're here with us today. And if you are here for the first time or the first time in a long time, we want to ask you to fill out a connection card. You'll find them in the seats ahead of you. If you take one out and fill it out, take it to the back corner there at the end of the service and collect one of those gift bags or mugs back there with information in it. And I think there's some candy in there too, if I'm not mistaken. We'd like you to take that home as a remembrance of your visit with us today. That's not just a Christmas gift. That's our we want to bless you with that as a remembrance of your visit with us today. So thank you for being here with us, and we're looking forward to good service. Now, normally what we do at this point in the service is to look at our Bible quiz question of the week before we do our offering. This week, the question is this. Why was Jesus raised in Galilee instead of Judea? Why was Jesus raised in Galilee instead of Judea? Last week's question was pretty tricky. There was only one correct answer to that. This week was even trickier. There were no correct answers to this question. That has only happened, I think, once or twice before since we started doing this Bible quiz question of the week. And the answer is found in Matthew chapter 2, part of the Christmas story. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem, you'll recall that Joseph was warned of God in a dream to flee to Egypt to avoid the slaughter of the babies that Herod ordered. And so they were there until the death of Herod. And then we find in verse 22, when he heard, that is Joseph, when he heard that Archelaus did reign in Judea in the room of his father Herod, he was afraid to go thither. Notwithstanding, being warned of God in a dream, he turned aside into the parts of Galilee. And he came and dwelt in a city called Nazareth, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophets, he shall be called a Nazarene. So that is why he was raised in Galilee instead of Judea. So a little complicated there and a little tricky. So no correct answer to that one. So the gift card will continue, and we'll, hopefully somebody will win it next week. If you'd like to get in on that Bible quiz question, put the correct answer and your correct name and put it on a slip of paper of any kind and drop it in the box at the end of the lobby, and hopefully we'll draw your name next week for the gift card. Ushers, if you would take your places, let's prepare to give back to the Lord a portion of that which he's given to us in recognition of the fact that it all comes from him originally, and we're giving out of a heart of faith, trusting God to meet our needs after we've given to him of his first fruits, right? More about that during the message today. Let's go to the Lord in prayer and ask his blessings on the offering. Brother Rick, if you would, please. Amen. God bless you as you give.
Isaiah 9:7, of the increase of his governance and peace, there shall be no end. Would you please stand? Join us, please.
The stars in the sky look down.
Comfortable for just a couple minutes. We've got a special song to share with you.
Jesus, Jesus, oh, what a wonderful child. Jesus, Jesus, so lovely, meek and mild. New life, new hope, new joy he brings. Won't you listen to the angels sing? Glory, glory, glory to the newborn King.
He was heralded by the angels. He was born in a lowly manger. The Virgin Mary was his mother, and Joseph was his earthly father. The wise men came from afar. They were guided by the shining star to see King Jesus where he lay in a manger filled with hay. Stand up with us.
Jesus, Jesus, oh, Jesus, so lonely, meek and mild. New life, new hope, new joy he brings. Won't you listen to the angels sing? Glory, glory, glory to the newborn King.
Jesus, Jesus,
Jesus,
Jesus.
Jesus,
so
lovely, meek and mild. New life,
new light,
new hope,
new hope, new joy
he
brings.
Won't you listen
to the angels sing?
Glory, glory, glory to the newborn King. Glory, glory, glory.
Amen. Praise the Lord. You want to have a seat? Be comfortable, please. Pastor Paul.
Amen. That's good. All right. If you would, take your Bibles and turn to Luke chapter 2. Luke chapter 2. We're going to look at the same passage that Brother Harry quoted in his opening announcement video. That was no accident. Luke chapter 2. And if you are there, let's begin reading in verse 21. And it says, "And when 8 days were accomplished for the circumcising of the child, his name was called Jesus, which was so named of the angel before he was conceived in the womb. And when the days of her purification, according to the law of Moses, were accomplished, they brought him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every male that openeth the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice according to that which is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or 2 young pigeons. And behold, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon, and the same man was just and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Ghost was upon him. And it was revealed unto him by the Holy Ghost that he should not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And he came by the Spirit into the temple. And when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him after the custom of the law, then took he him up in his arms and blessed God and said, Lord, now lettest thy servant depart in peace according to thy word, For mine eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared before the face of all people, a light to lighten the Gentiles and the glory of thy people Israel. And Joseph and his mother marveled at those things which were spoken of him. And Simeon blessed them and said unto Mary his mother, behold, this child is set for the fall and rising again of many in Israel, and for a sign which shall be spoken against. Yea, a sword shall pierce through thine own soul also, that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed. And there was one Anna, a prophetess, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was of a great age and had lived with her husband 7 years from her virginity. And she was a widow of about 84 years, which departed not from the temple, but served God with fastings and prayers night and day. And she, coming in that instant, gave thanks likewise unto the Lord, and spake of him to all them that looked for redemption in Jerusalem. And when they had performed all things according to the law of the Lord, they returned unto Galilee to their own city Nazareth, and the child grew and waxed strong in spirit, filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Shall we, Father, thank you so much again for all that you are and all that you do for us. Father, we're so grateful that we can call ourselves your children if we have, of course, repented of our sin and trusted in your Son as Savior. Thank you, Father, for giving us the privilege of calling you our Father and of coming into your throne room. Father, thank you for your Holy Spirit who lives in us and ministers to us. And I ask, Father, that he would fulfill that ministry today in us, that you would take, he would take our your word and apply it to our hearts. Help us, Father, to learn with open hearts, open ears, and above all, that our responses would glorify you. Father, may we look into the perfect law of liberty and see ourselves as you see us. Show us the flaws that are there. Help us, Father, to yield ourselves once again and just honor you with all that we are from this point until the next time we meet. For we ask it in Jesus' name, for his sake, and with thanksgiving. Amen. We have been talking in this brief Christmas series, calling it the Christmas story, a Christmas story, not the other one that you're going to be seeing 24 hours this coming Christmas Eve, but the real Christmas story. And we looked first at the announcement of the Lord's birth, and then last week we looked at the arrival of his birth. Today we want to look at afterwards. What happened after Christmas? Normally when we talk about Christmas, we talk about the Christmas story, we talk about the events leading up to the birth of Christ. We talk about the announcement by the angels to both Mary and Joseph. We talk about her going to visit her cousin Elizabeth, although we didn't cover that this year. We talk about the angels appearing to the shepherds outside in the fields of Bethlehem. We talk about them going to visit the baby. We talk about the wise men coming to bring gifts to the child. And then we kind of drop it there. But there was more to the story. What happened after the birth of Christ? And so we're looking today at a passage that takes place 8 days after Jesus was born. And I'm just going to talk about three simple points and we'll be done today. But the first thing I want to talk about is the Lord's dedication. The Lord's dedication. You know, one of the things I like about the Lord is that he never asks us to do anything that he doesn't already do first. I can't think of anything that we go through that he hasn't already experienced. And this is one of those things. The Lord was dedicated to the Lord. And I said that right. The Lord was dedicated to the Lord 8 days after his birth. He fulfilled the law. In Leviticus chapter 12, verses 1 through 4, we see the law that's given there by Moses to God through Moses to the people of Israel. And it says, and the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, saying, if a woman have conceived seed and born a man-child, then she shall be unclean 7 days. According to the days of the separation for her infirmity shall she be unclean. And in the eighth day of the flesh of his foreskin shall be circumcised. Now it goes on to talk about some other things there. We'll drop that there and go on to Matthew chapter 5, verses 17 and 18. In which the Lord, in his Sermon on the Mount, explains to the people there who were listening to him, primarily his disciples, but other people were listening as well. He says, think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. He goes on to say, for verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled. And this took place in his life beginning at his birth. Now, a couple of weeks ago, I mentioned that God sent Jesus to be born to Joseph and Mary for one of the many reasons he did that was that they were an Orthodox Jewish family. They had learned the law. They'd kept the law. And they would continue keeping the law, raising him in the nurture and an admonition of the Lord. You've heard those words here before, haven't you? So that's why he put Jesus into that family. We know from this passage and others as well that they were an Orthodox Jewish family. They did everything by the book, which is why we do things by the book here at Crossroads, or at least we try to. And so when he was born, they waited 8 days, and then he was circumcised that day. Now, I won't go into a whole lot of detail because it probably brings back painful memories for some of you. But I'm told by medical people that the 8th day after birth is when the baby is least sensitive. And it's the best time to circumcise because it's less painful on the 8th day than it is on the 7th or the 9th day. That's interesting, isn't it? But that's the way the Lord planned it. So circumcision always took place on the 8th day. And the circumcision was an outward sign of what takes place within. It was a sign to the Old Testament Jews. That's one of the things that makes a person Jewish. They are circumcised, and that identifies with them with the nation of Israel. Nowadays, this is one of the things we do to identify with the Lord. We get baptized. Baptism does not save us. Baptism gets us wet, and it also is an outward sign of what takes place within. We bury people in the water by baptism. It pictures the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Christ. It's an outward sign of what takes place within. Now, you and I, well, let me ask this question. Are there any Jewish people here? I've asked that question before, and on occasion, I've had one or two people raise their hands. No Jewish people here today? Okay, that means we're all Gentiles, because there's only two kinds of people in the world, Jew and Gentile, right? Since you're not Jewish, you're Gentile. But if you are saved, do you realize that you are part of Israel? You realize that you are a spiritual Jew? The Apostle Paul said this in the book of Romans. Now, Paul was as Jewish as you can get, and he lists his pedigree in the book of Galatians. He was a Hebrew of the Hebrews, as he described himself, a Pharisee of the Pharisees. He was ultra-Orthodox to the point where he would arrest, prosecute, and try and convict and execute Jews who had converted from their faith. He was that strong in his faith. But he said that if you are saved, if you whether you're Jewish or Gentile, if you have come to the point in your life when you realize that you're a sinner in need of a Savior and you repent of your sin and trust in Jesus Christ as your Savior, you are spiritually Jewish. And you have been circumcised in your heart, which he said is the only thing that matters. Okay, right? So what's interesting here is that Jesus was circumcised, dedicated to the Lord on the 8th day. Now, he didn't need to picture outwardly anything that took place inwardly, right? Jesus did not need to get saved. Would you agree with that? So it wasn't necessary for him to get circumcised to demonstrate any spiritual change that took place in him, just as it wasn't necessary for him to get baptized to picture any spiritual change that took place in him, right? Why did he do those things? Why did he allow himself to be circumcised? Now you say, what do you mean, how did he allow himself? He was an infant. He couldn't do anything. He was God. He could do anything at any point in his life. So he was directing his parents to do all that, to take him to the temple, to have him dedicated to the Lord, to be circumcised to the Lord. All those things are things that he does because they are in the law. And he was not come to destroy the law, but to fulfill it. Everything he did in his whole life, whether in thought or word or deed, was to fulfill the law. He never, ever asks us to do anything that he hasn't already done. So when he tells us we need to obey his commandments, well, that's exactly what he means, and he did it himself. Not only was he dedicated to the Lord on the eighth day, not only was he circumcised on the eighth day, he was also named on the eighth day. We're told that's when they gave his name. Verse 21, and 8 days were accomplished for the circumcising of the child. His name was called Jesus, which was so named of the angel before he was conceived in the womb. And that sounds odd that they waited until the eighth day to give him a name. But you know what? That's not that unusual. Even in our culture, well, maybe not today, but say 100 years ago, 150 years ago, 200 years ago, it was very, very common not to name the child until after it was born, and a little bit older. I found that out not from Scripture, although you'd think I should have picked it up from there, but I found that out when I started doing genealogy and started going to cemeteries and doing an investigation. And I would see a lot of tombstones with the name of maybe the mom and the dad and infant child, infant boy, baby girl, or whatever it is. They would just put that on there, no name of the child. And oftentimes I would see just a mother and an unnamed child. And I began to find out that the death rate for newborns was so high years ago that they waited until the child was older to find out if it was going to survive before they gave it a name. I don't know if that's why the custom was this way here, but on the eighth day is when they would give the child a name. They figured after 8 days, well, it's probably going to be okay, so we'll give it a name. But I've seen families that had names of infant children, and the baby would be named. It would die very, very young. They would have another baby. They'd give it the same name as the previous baby. And that one might die. They'd have a third baby and give that the same name as the previous two. And they keep going until one of them stuck, you know. Kind of reminds me of George Foreman. Anybody know, are familiar with George Foreman and his family? How many kids does he have? How many boys does he have? He's got several boys. You know what the names of his boys are? George, right? That's the way to get your kids' attention when something happens. George, come here! And then all five of them come running in. Yeah. But Jesus was named on the eighth day. Now, the name was given to him by God, his Father, through the angel to his parents, right? But actually, that goes all the way back to the Old Testament. And let me just read one passage that will indicate this. Zechariah chapter 6, verse 9 through 13. And the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, then take silver and gold and make crowns and set them upon the head of Joshua, the son of Jozadak, the high priest. And speak unto him, saying, thus speaketh the Lord of hosts, saying, behold, the man whose name is the branch. See that? All capital letters. And he shall grow up out of his place, and he shall build the temple of the Lord. Even he shall build the temple of the Lord, and he shall bear the glory, and it shall sit and rule upon his throne, and he shall be a priest upon his throne, and the council of peace shall be between them both. This is a prophecy of Jesus Christ. Now, there was a real man by this name. Make no mistake about that. His name was Joshua. But you know what Joshua's, the Hebrew name Joshua is sometimes pronounced by Jewish people, Yeshua, which is the same name as the Greek name Jesus. The Hebrew is Joshua, the Greek is Jesus. They both mean the same thing. It means, you probably can tell me what it means, salvation. Thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins, the angel told Joseph in Matthew chapter 1. His name means salvation, literally. So Joshua in the Old Testament is the name Jesus in the New Testament. This prophecy, this person named Joshua, he's given the name the branch. Now, this is not talking specifically about this fellow in the Old Testament. This is another name for Jesus Christ, the branch. All capital letters. Jesus has many names throughout the Bible. He's the angel of the Lord. He's the son of righteousness. He is the Alpha and Omega. He's the first and the last. He's got all kinds of names. And all his names are descriptions of his character. And that's what this name is as well. This name was planned for Jesus Christ thousands of years. In fact, you might say an eternity before he was born. The name means something. Bible names mean something. And so that's why he was given that name. Matthew 1:21 was the verse I quoted just a second ago. This was the angel's pronouncement to Joseph. And she shall bring forth a son, thou shalt call his name Jesus. Although when the angel said that, he wasn't speaking Greek, most likely. He was probably speaking either Hebrew or Aramaic, and he probably said, thou shalt call his name Yeshua. That was his name. But not only was Jesus dedicated, not only was he circumcised, not only was he named, he was also, and this is going to sound strange, he was redeemed on the eighth day. Now think about that for a minute. The Redeemer, capital R, was redeemed. Now, we find this in the Old Testament as well. Bear with me a little bit. I know that going back to the Old Testament a lot is a little bit, it's maybe sometimes tedious, but it's there for a reason. In Exodus chapter 13, verse 1, and the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, all the firstborn. Sanctify means to set apart, make holy, separate from, separate to. That's what it's talking about. Sanctify unto me all the firstborn, whatsoever openeth the womb among the children of Israel, both of man and of beast. It is mine, he says. That applies to Jesus. Jesus was Mary's firstborn child, right? But it also goes on to say in verse 13 of that same chapter, all the firstborn of man among thy children shalt thou redeem. Redeem. And then it goes on to say, and I'm not going to take the time to read the next lengthy passage that describes the various sacrifices that can be brought to redeem a firstborn child. You can read that for yourself in Leviticus chapter 12. It gives those different sacrifices. But I want to make the point again. Jesus did not need to be redeemed, but he was redeemed, sanctified unto the Lord at birth to fulfill the law. Because we are to do those things, he never asks us to do anything he won't already do. That's why that's there. So Jesus, the Redeemer, was redeemed. And I put that in quotation marks because he didn't need to be redeemed. He wasn't redeemed in the sense we were redeemed, but that means he was set apart to the Lord at birth. Mary and Joseph were poor people. Now, one of the sacrifices that is to be given or can be given to redeem a firstborn is a lamb. But they were very poor people. So poor that they gave the least amount of offering that was acceptable, and that's two birds. But that was a sacrifice that they gave and offered to the Lord at his dedication, at his sanctification ceremony, redemption ceremony, whatever you want to call that. And the scripture teaches that they were poor. Jesus was born into a poor family, and he himself was poor. In 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9, Paul writes to the Corinthians and says, for you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that ye through his poverty might be rich. When he says that Jesus was rich, well, what an understatement. I mean, he's God, right? He lived in heaven. He had a throne for heaven's sake. For heaven's sake. Okay? Just want to make sure you got that part, okay? He lived in heaven. He had all the angels at his disposal, surrounding him night and day, crying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. Any wish or thought or desire on his part was instantly fulfilled. He had all these angels ministering to him, all the riches and wealth of heaven, and he gave it all up. This is amazing to me. I think of the word inconceivable from The Princess Bride, okay? It's inconceivable to me that he would, and then every time I think of that word, and I keep thinking, well, you keep using that word, you don't really know what it means. So that's very true. I can't conceive of what it means for the Lord to give up all those things and become one of his creation. For God, the creator of the universe, the one who spoke not just this world, but all worlds throughout the entire universe into existence by the power of his voice, for him to condescend to become an infant human baby who can't dress himself, who can't feed himself, who needs to have someone else change his diapers. Think of all the things an infant baby is totally helpless and dependent on its parents, right? The God who created Mary became totally dependent on Mary. It's just an amazing thought that he became one of us in order to eventually redeem us back to himself. It's an amazing thought. And that's what Paul is talking about, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that ye through his poverty might be rich. You and I will spend eternity in heaven someday. If you know the Lord is your Savior, we will be in a mansion in heaven. We will have access to all those things that he had for eternity past, and he wants us to be with him. And you and I are going to have access to heaven. We have access to heaven now, but we will actually physically be in his presence in heaven forever and ever because he gave it all up to become one of us at Christmas time. It's amazing. But every encounter with God requires a sacrifice. Since the fall in Eden, since Adam and Eve sinned against God in Eden, we're going through that on Wednesday nights. We're going through the book of Genesis. We've been talking about this at length for the last several weeks. But every meeting with God since the Garden of Eden has required some sort of sacrifice. From the skins that God provided them with in the Garden of Eden. Or when we meet with God in prayer every day, in order for us to have our prayers answered to God, by God, we have to present ourselves a living sacrifice to God. If we want our prayers answered, we must yield our will to his and want what God wants, not what we want. That's a sacrifice. Everything that we do in order to be in God's presence requires a sacrifice, and that's the same thing here. The Apostle Paul said, I die daily, 1 Corinthians 15:31. I die daily. He recognized that. Galatians 2:20 says, I am crucified with Christ. I am. Current tense, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. That's what he's talking about in greater detail when he says, I die daily. We have to reckon ourselves to be dead unto sin and alive unto God through Lord Jesus Christ. That is how we maintain a relationship with him and allow him to live his life through this body that we have. This is our body, but it's not ours. It's bought with a price. You know, it's his. Our life is his. When he died for us on a cross like that, he bought every one of us. So that sacrifice gets us into his presence. The second thing I want to talk about, not just his dedication, I want to talk about Simeon for just a second. Simeon's fulfillment here. Simeon had been told at some point by the Lord that he would not die until he had seen the Messiah. Wow, what a promise that would be. You know, you and I are all hoping to see the second coming of Christ, aren't we? We're hoping to see the rapture, but we don't know that we will see the rapture. Wouldn't it be pretty cool if at some point in your life, God had come to you personally and told you that you would not die, but you would go up in the rapture? What would that be like? How would that change your life? Well, you wouldn't be afraid to do anything. Boy, if I knew that I was going to live until the rapture was going to take place, I wouldn't mind going to Cedar Point and getting on Millennium Force. But until then, I'm not going to tempt God, right? Right? But there would be nothing to fear. We would know that God wasn't done with us until he came back, right? That's where Simeon was. He knew that he was going to see the Messiah before he died. Now, here he is. He's in the temple. He sees Jesus. I have no idea, and we're not told, how he knew when he saw this baby that this was the Messiah. Because Jesus just looked like an ordinary baby, just like any other baby. But somehow he knew this was the Messiah. Now, at that point, he might have started worrying about dying. He said, oh, boy, now I could die at any minute because now I've seen him. Okay. But somehow he knew this was the Messiah. And he was fulfilled by that. Warren Wiersbe said, and I quote, he was a man who was led by the Spirit of God, taught by the Word of God, obedient to the will of God, and therefore he was privileged to see the salvation of God. That's a great thought for Simeon. So he waited, the scripture says, he waited for the consolation of Israel. And the scripture also says in this passage we just read, he was led by the Spirit into the temple. He just felt compelled to go to church that day. I don't know if he was on duty that day, if he had things he had to do, but the Holy Spirit led him to church, which is great. I mean, you know, going to church, you never know what you're going to find in church, right? You never know what's going to happen in church. I've seen some amazing things in church services. So have you. And sometimes when they've happened, we've said, you know, at that point, boy, you never know what's going to happen in church, right? We've seen people get saved we never thought would get saved. We've seen people get baptized. We've seen cool things happen. I've seen that happen on and off through my whole life in ministry as a Christian, going back to the early 70s. It's neat, the things that happen in church. And here, Simeon is led to church. He had no idea why the Holy Spirit wanted him to go into the temple that day, but here he sees the Messiah. What if he had ignored the Holy Spirit's leading and not gone to church that day? He would have missed it. He would have missed it. But a lot of people won't go to church. Even when the Spirit leads them, they won't go. A lot of folks don't take going to church seriously. But some people would rather go anywhere but church. Rather go to football games or basketball games or hockey games or baseball games or stuff like that. But you know, when you get to thinking about football games, thinking about Ohio State football, for example. You ever been to an Ohio State game, you guys? In Ohio State game. It's really something, isn't it? But, you know, I've decided I'm not going to go anymore. I've been to a number of games, but I'm not going to go to Ohio State football games anymore. I just don't want to do it. I've kind of had it with it. You can't get me near Ohio Stadium anymore because every time I went to Ohio Stadium, they asked me for money. Every time. They wanted my money. When I went there, you know, they had ushers, but the ushers, you know, they're there to show you to your seat, but they weren't really very friendly to me. And the other people at the stadium weren't really very friendly to me either. You know, I went in there and I walked past all kinds of people. The usher showed me to my seat, but, you know, I walked past all these people. Not one of them shook my hand and said, hi, welcome to Ohio Stadium. We're glad that you're here. Not one of them. I went to a lot of games. When Woody was coach and Earl Bruce, and I don't know if I went during the John Cooper years. I don't remember much about that time. Jim Tressel was coach, and then, Urban Meyer was coach. And in all the games that I went to and visited and spent money and watched the game and cheered for the team, not once did the coach call on me. Not one time. I never got a call from any of the coaches. With all the time and all the money I spent there. And then when I went there, I sat on the seats. Those seats weren't very comfortable at all. They're hard. You know, there's no backs to them unless you bring your own stadium seat. But it was just hard and uncomfortable. And they were long. Man, these services, I mean, these games lasted for hours and hours. And, you know, I noticed as I looked around, one time I sat on the opposite side of the field up in C deck. And I noticed and I realized that I was surrounded by hypocrites. Some of the people who were in the stadium were actually cheering for the other team. And then there were other people I noticed who spent a lot of time during the game on their phones, not paying attention to the game. You know, they weren't really there for the right reason. You know, it really bugged me. Do you get where I'm going with this? Okay. But there are people who won't go to church for those reasons. And it makes about as much sense, doesn't it? You know, when you don't go to church because there's other hypocrites there, what you are essentially doing is saying the hypocrites are more faithful to the Lord in church than you are. But Simeon was led by the Holy Spirit to go to church, and it's probably a good thing he did. He was probably really glad that he followed the Holy Spirit's leading and went to church that day, and he met the Messiah. Because really neat things happen at church a lot of times. And because of that, he praised God for being blessed. He was able to hold his salvation in his hands. Can you imagine that? We sing about Mary, you know, did you know the baby you're holding would be the one who would die for your own sin? And that's exactly what Simeon says to her. A sword shall pierce through thine own soul also. That's a reference to Hebrews 4:12, which I'm not going to go into today. But what he's essentially saying is this baby is going to die for you too. Now, I'll shoot some other theology in the head for other denominations and churches who believe that Mary was not a sinner. But that says she was. That her baby died for her, or would die for her. And Simeon realized it when he held this baby in his hands. And he's looking down at his own salvation, the Lamb of God, who would die for his own sin. He's holding his Messiah in his hands. Just an amazing thought. And then he was a blessing to others. Simeon was a blessing to others for having been blessed. He blessed Joseph and Mary. Wouldn't that be neat to have an opportunity to say something to Joseph and Mary and encourage them that they are going to be raising the Messiah in their home, in their family, and he could be an encouragement to them? That was an amazing thing, amazing experience for him. But then we go to the third point, Anna. Anna, the prophetess, her announcement is given in verses 36 through 40. Now, she was a widow. She was 84 years old. She was a widow, and she spent all her time in the temple fasting and praying. That was a great ministry for her. You know, a lot of folks, when they get to a certain age, think that, well, I'm too old to do this. I'm too old to do that. We need to get some younger people to do this and that and the other thing. I'm done. I'm going to retire, not just from their job, but for ministry. And folks, we never need to do that. There's always something that needs to be done in ministry. And sometimes the best ministry is just fasting and praying. You know, some of the greatest ministers in our church's history have been elderly widows who prayed a lot. And I'm not just saying that. I have literally felt those prayers. I remember certain ones. Mrs. Higginbotham. Some of you remember Tommy Higginbotham. His mom used to live on East North Broadway. She was a prayer warrior. And I really noticed, when she died, I noticed that there was something spiritually missing in the world. She prayed a lot, and I could tell. Now, she's been gone for, 30 years, probably. And I still remember the effect of her prayers. Another one I remember was Winifred Tiller. More recent, some of you will remember Winifred Tiller. She was another one like that. When she passed away, I noticed. I could tell there was something missing. She was a prayer warrior. And when she said she was going to pray for you, she did. She didn't just say it. And she got a hold of God. And I could tell there was an impact there because when she was gone, that stopped. Something was different. You know, prayer warriors have a great ministry. That's really, really important. Charles Spurgeon was one of the greatest preachers in world history. He had a huge impact in England and also on this continent in the 19th century. But when Charles Spurgeon was preaching, there were a group of people under him on the ground floor. I think it was, if I'm not mistaken, it was in the boiler room. There was a group of people who prayed for him and for the people who were listening to him during the services. The whole time the service was going on, they were down in the basement in the boiler room praying. And that is, many people have said, that was the difference in his ministry. That's what made him a great preacher and a great pastor. That's what Anna's ministry was. She was fasting and praying. So thank God for widows who are faithful prayer warriors. She just happened to be present when the Savior came in. You'll notice that when in verse, oh, where is it? Verse 38. of the passage we just read. And she coming in that instant, in other words, she just happened to show up at the moment when Jesus came into the temple but with Joseph and Mary, and Simeon saw him and held him, and she came in at just at that time. I don't think it was any accident that she showed up right then, but she showed up and happened to be there when Simeon met the infant Jesus, and she met him too, and she began to praise the Lord for him. Verse 38, it says, and gave thanks likewise unto the Lord, and not only that, but she talked about him to anyone who would listen. Verse 38 and 39, it says, and spake of him to all them that looked for redemption in Jerusalem. She told everybody she could about Jesus and who he was and what he would do in the future. We need to be willing to tell other people as well. Right? Use every opportunity to do that. I'm told about a barber. I don't know if Otis and Esther are able to watch today. Otis is a barber. He has a barber shop. And this fellow, this barber in Scarborough, England, many years ago, he felt it was his duty to witness to everybody who came into his shop. Otis pretty much does that too. He invites everybody to church who comes into his shop. This barber in Scarborough, England, witnessed to all his customers, but he wasn't always careful about doing it. One day he had a customer in his chair, and he picked up his straight razor, and he was stropping his razor like this, and he said to his customer, after he got the thing around his neck, you know, the apron kind of thing he ties around his neck, and stropping the razor, and he says to his customer, sir, are you prepared to meet your God? That guy got up out of the chair with the lather still on his face. But we do need to witness to people, right? We need to share the gospel with everybody we come in contact with. Let me just conclude with this. Are you prepared to meet your God? It is December 20th. We're almost to the end of the month. We're almost to the end of the year. And I am really, really thankful for that. A lot of years, I'm sad to see the year close out. This year, I'm not sad to see it at all. In the next week or so, you're going to see programs on TV. You're going to see articles in the newspaper or in magazines listing all the celebrities who have died this past year. One of the things I like to look at on Turner Classic Movies, they always have that, an in memoriam segment. And they show all the actors and cinematographers and directors and writers and everybody who have passed away this past year. You'll be seeing a lot of those this next coming week. You'll see retrospectives on events of this past year. When you and I look back at where we were a year ago, in December of last year, and we look at the retrospective of our church and our families this past year, one of the first things that comes to mind for me are the people we've lost this past year, who were here in this auditorium a year ago today and are not here now. They're in heaven with the Lord, which is a great place for them, but we miss them. My question for you is, are you prepared to meet your God? Because none of us have a guarantee that we will be sitting in this auditorium 1 year from today. That's not a thought we want to think about. Last week, I got a message from someone. I did a funeral maybe 5 or 6 weeks ago. And on the front row at the funeral, of course, the family is all there in the front row. And on the far left-hand side, there was a fellow. I didn't know him, but he was part of the family that I know very well. And I gave the gospel, as I always do at a funeral, and had an invitation, had everybody bow their heads, and I led them in a prayer of salvation, explaining that the prayer doesn't save you, but the thought, the what you believe in your heart is what saves you. And a number of people prayed that prayer, and then I asked them to raise their hand if they prayed that prayer. Well, a number of people raised their hands, so many I couldn't count them all, and I was counting, and I thought that fellow raised his hand, but I wasn't sure. So I talked to him afterwards. I told anybody, if they want to talk to me after the service or at the cemetery, feel free to do so. Well, I talked to him briefly after the service. He didn't ask many questions or indicate anything to me, but we talked to him briefly after the service and a little bit at the cemetery as well, at the chapel, at the mausoleum, where we had another service there. And we talked briefly there. That was on a Friday. I believe it was a Friday. Either there were Friday or Saturday. That fellow was in perfect health on Friday and Saturday, but he died on Tuesday. Young man. And I got a text from the family just last week letting me know that. And they weren't sure if I knew that or not. And they were thankful that the gospel was made clear that day in the service. They don't know if he was saved or not, but they said at least he had the opportunity. And what I'm sharing with you is that you don't know whether this might be the last service that you're in. I said a little bit ago, you don't know what's going to happen in church. You never know what's going to happen in church. I remember years ago in this room, back when the seats were different now than they are now, they were straight across here and then angled on the side. And right back there, just a few feet in front of where Charlie's sitting right now, there I remember a fella standing there. And he did the same thing, raised his hand during the invitation. He did not come forward, but he raised his hand and said he needed to be saved. He was perfectly healthy one Sunday, and by the next Sunday, he was already dead and buried in the ground. That was his last Sunday. He had no idea that would be his last Sunday to be in church. He had no idea that one week later, he would be in the ground. He'd be in his grave. I don't like to use emotional appeals during invitation. What I'm saying is, don't take life for granted. None of us knows where we're going to be a year from now. None of us knows where we're going to be a week from now. Are you ready to meet your God? Simeon showed up for church that day. He met his God. He had no idea he was going to that day. Anna showed up for church that day. She had no idea she was going to meet her God that day. Is this the day that you're going to meet God? It could be. If you've never met him, if you've never given your sin, your soul, yourself to him, today is a great day to do that. Whether it's here or online, you can do that at home as well. Well, we want to give you an opportunity to respond to whatever the Lord's speaking to you about, and we do that right now. Let's go ahead and stand as the praise team comes and sings some invitation songs. We want to give you the opportunity to respond to what you've heard it here today. The best gift you could get at Christmas time is the gift of salvation. That's Jesus' name, Yeshua. Jesus means salvation. He was gift-wrapped in swaddling clothes, laid in a manger as God's gift to you and me. If you've never accepted the gift of salvation in Jesus Christ, today is a great day to do that. Father, may your will be done in this invitation we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
When we walk with the Lord, thank you.
Be seated for just a moment. A couple of things we want to talk about. Tonight, the evening service will be a movie night. As you saw in the opening announcements, we're going to be showing the film The Nativity Story. It's a really good portrayal of the Nativity. Very, very well done, very accurately done. So we'll be showing that tonight in the Connector. We're going to be over in the Connector to watch that. We will have popcorn and drinks available for you tonight. So if you want other snacks, bring those with you. But we'll be having those for you tonight. There's no charge for that, of course, but that's going to be our evening service. Now, for those of you who have been asking about the live stream, I mentioned Wednesday night on the broadcast that we had found out Wednesday that we are prohibited by terms of our licensing contract to live stream that. We cannot broadcast that on Facebook Live or YouTube. That would be a violation of copyright law. And so we understand that. I appreciate them for allowing us to have the license. We paid for our license, and they get a royalty off of that. But that limits us to showing it on-site only to those who are here on-site and those who are members and guests. But we cannot broadcast it off the premises. So for those of you who are limited to being at home, I apologize for that. I'm sorry that you won't be able to watch tonight's service, but that is the restriction in our contract. So I wanted to let you know about that because I had a lot of questions about that. Also, I've had a lot of questions about our schedule for the holidays. We will not have a Wednesday night service this week or the following week because Christmas Eve. Christmas Eve comes Thursday. So we will have a service Thursday night. That will be our midweek service. So we will not have a Wednesday night service. And then also, we will not have Young at Hearts this Thursday or the following Thursday. Christmas Eve, New Year's Eve, no Young at Hearts for the next couple weeks. So I wanted to let you know about that. We will have the Christmas Eve service here on Thursday night, 6 o'clock, and it will be about 1 hour in length. I just wanted to let you know that. It's really one of our best services of the year, one of the most fun services of the year. Can I say that? I'm not trying to denigrate the rest of the services, but that's a really, really special service. It'll be candlelight, and we'll have a lot of fun that night. It's a very, very different type of service. We just wanted to let you know about those. So that's the holiday schedule. If you want to have more information, or if I went through this too quickly, call the church office, and we'll be glad to answer any questions you have about that as well. Now, before we leave, I want to ask Tammy if you'd come. Yes. There's no other Tammys here.
I'm fired.
Yeah.
Yeah,
there you go. So this coming Saturday is your birthday.
It is.
Yeah. So, yeah, happy birthday.
Thank you.
And we won't talk about which birthday that is. So, but anyway, we wanted to give you a card and a gift there as well for your birthday. I appreciate all that you do all year long. And Tammy is the one who really runs the church. She's in the nerve center of the church in the office and really helps things keep going and keeps me on track with a lot of things. So I appreciate her very much. Happy birthday to you.
Yeah.
All right. Great. All right. Brother Greg, I'm going to ask if you'd come up here and close us out in prayer so that the folks on watching online can hear you as well as see you. Okay. So God bless you all, and we'll see you tonight at 6 o'clock. Brother Greg.
Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for today, and we thank you for the service that we heard today. We thank you for all of the faithful servants that are here and for the faithful servants that you tell us about throughout Scripture. people like Anna, people like Simeon, and even people like Mary and Joseph, who we've spoken so much about. Lord, we ask that you'll be glorified as we go forth today, that you'll bless us all and bring us back in our next appointed meeting. And we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.